Before I introduce tonight's inaugural speaker, Kent Bloomer, let me explain some of the reasoning behind staging such a series at this point in time. We are currently witnessing the early stages of an ornamental renaissance in architectural practice. Ornament has once more become a widely spoken language in international architecture. We can detect its utterances in recent works of such luminaries as Rem, Toyo Ito, FOA, Yunoki, and most of all Herzog and Dömeron. This reemergence is often attributed to the new methods of digital manufacturing, ranging from CNC formwork milling to five-axis laser cutting or robotic bricklaying, which finally allow for intricate and complex forms characteristic of ornament to translate from digital modeling into built reality. These industrial processes, as they now become more economically viable, have assisted in overcoming the cost and labor-intensive and often disappearing craft methods that traditionally formed the basis of ornament. As a result, contemporary practice seems to effortlessly embrace the eloquent exuberance of an architectural idiom that has long thought to be lost. Interestingly, the ease with which this renaissance seems to evolve through practical applications does not at all translate into our theoretical discourse. Ask any two architects to discuss the topic of ornament, and you will find that they almost certainly could not agree on a shared definition of the term. There are several reasons for this notorious indeterminacy of the word ornament, especially when applied to architecture. The most obvious one is its absence from architectural discourse for almost a century. After Adolf Loos's Ornament and Crime, written 100 years ago, there simply hasn't been any ornamental theory that would keep abreast with shifts in the tectonic nature of buildings. Much that is written today confuses the terms of ornament with those of decoration or pattern. The vocabularies of ornament are all but lost. And so it seems the right time for some groundwork to be done, to lay some solid foundations upon which new theories of ornament can be constructed. This series of lectures is aimed at doing exactly that. And who better to kick off this mammoth task than Kent Bloomer? I know from personal experience that his seminal book titled The Nature of Ornament, Rhythm and the Metamorphosis in Architecture, published in 2000, has to be the first port of call for any daring soul foolish enough to venture into the treacherous terra incognita of ornament. The book is a rich concoction of art history, architectural theory, linguistics and polemics. It comes as no surprise that its author is very much a Renaissance man, a bit of a polymath himself. Kent Bloomer studied physics and architecture at MIT and then sculpture at Yale University. He has been teaching as a professor of architecture at Yale for 42 years now, and he still runs a studio on the theory and design of ornament there now. His illustrious academic career includes a five-year stint at the Carnegie Mellon Institute of Technology in the early 60s, and he served as a visiting critic at many universities, including UCLA, UT Austin, Harvard, McGill, and Columbia. Kent Bloomer is also the principal and founder of Bloomer Studio in New Haven, Connecticut, and has served as its chief designer since 1965. His professional activities focus on sculpture and large-scale architectural ornament. Major projects in public art and architectural ornament include the three domes for the New Orleans World Exposition, roof ornaments for the Harold Washington Library in Chicago, a large tracery for the Ronald Reagan Washington National Airport, which was designed by Cesare Pelli, and the decorative frieze on the public library in Nashville, Tennessee, which was designed by Robert Stern Architects. In addition, he has designed light fixtures for Central Park and 8th Avenue in New York and for several university campuses. Kent Bloomer's sculpture has been exhibited by numerous museums and galleries, including the Museum of Modern Art in New York, the Los Angeles County Museum of Art in California, the Wadsworth Athenaeum in Hartford, Connecticut, and Carnegie Museum of Art in Pittsburgh. His work is included in the permanent collections of the Hirshhorn Gallery, Smithsonian Institution in Washington, the Yale University Art Gallery in New Haven, and the Carnegie Museum of Art in Pittsburgh. Besides the already mentioned Nature of Ornament, he is also the principal author with Charles W. Moore of Body, Memory, and Architecture, published by Yale University Press in 1977. And now he is back at DIA. After 22 years, so 22 years ago he gave a talk called Images of Nature. So we'll see how much has changed in those 22 years. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to our guest tonight, Kent Bloomer.
Thank you. I thank the directors, Mr. Steele, for allowing me to give this talk, and particularly Oliver for inviting me. It's great to be here at the ANA. This is my second time. It's an honor, in fact. So, thank you. And congratulations to you, Oliver, as well, for that incredible show you just put on in Basel. I didn't get to the show, but I was out of the country. I was in a different direction. But I did get the catalog, which is one of the really good journals. I call it a journal on the subject. I collect these journals, and it's right there on my shelf with these. So thank you and congratulations. The last lecture I gave in London was at the British Psychoanalytic Society, and that's where my lectures on ornament were going at that time. And when I gave the lecture, they told me to slow down, but that was the Psychoanalytic Society. I'm going to read part of this lecture, and the reason I do that is if I don't, I will digress. When I get onto the subject of ornament, I just fly in too many directions. So I can only control it by reading certain parts, and that I will do. So I'm just going to jump into it because I like to stay within a comfortable time frame and not draw out more than I have to. So forgive me for reading. I'll just start and say that 20th century modernist doctrines of architectural design radically focused on formal abstractions, systems of basic physical structure and raw space, choosing to discard ornament and to deny the function of decoration as well. In their quest for an allegedly pure and definitive new architecture, ornament became detached from professional practice, although it continued to flourish in other disciplines such as music. In the seminar on ornament, which I started at Yale in 1976, 32 years ago, this is dating me terribly, but here it is true. 32 years ago, we struggled. It was sort of a dark age at that time. We struggled to identify universal principles governing great ornament, treating it as a science as well as an art, while attempting to design ornament in the architecture of today's world. Within a few years, our research inspired me to actively produce ornament, to become an ornamenter. The Italians have a great word for that. It's an ornatista. A title that you don't hear very much. You're either decorators, but you don't. I'm going to phone my ornatista, see what they can. To become an ornamenter and to substantiate the project of ornament in the public domain. And I've been doing that for as long as the seminar. And longer, in fact. I was starting doing ornament without knowing what I was doing, that it was ornament. The early Latin definition of ornament was helpful. The ancient Latin verb ornare meant to equip something with ornamentum. The ancient Greek language did not have a word for ornament, although it seems that they were responsible for its emergence as a special category implicated with the term cosmos. The term ornare is crucial because it immediately declares ornament to be auxiliary to something. That is, there is ornament and there is the thing to be equipped, ornamented, upon which the ornament depends for its function and its illumination. Put the first slide on. I meant to start with this slide because on the left is Frank Lloyd Wright and on the right is Louis Sullivan. When I was a student, Frank Lloyd Wright was still alive and we were aware of this work. And of course, Louis Sullivan was one of his students. So when the word ornament was used in these years when it was practically banned from the studio, we all knew that Louis Sullivan did ornament. So that was the word for ornament was Louis Sullivan. In the same way that if Louis Armstrong did jazz, the word for jazz was Louis Armstrong. We had to pick a person rather than a topic. So these are beautiful examples. That's the Hollyhock House, which is very late. Frank Lloyd Wright was working on ornament until after the Second World War, which hasn't been sufficiently published. And of course, Louis Sullivan died in 1922, and he was still going. Now would you go to, I was saying that, something to be equipped upon which the ornament depends for its function. Next, 3 and 4. On the right is a Chinese chair with what I'm calling ornament, those figures that go like this, the figure in the back. And on the left is one of my early works, which was the location of a kind of leaf formation inside the cross section of an axis. So in both cases, you have something that has an object in order to exist. The keys have the chair, this has the cross section. The dyad between ornament and its host thus became an absolute, and I have to underline this, an absolute first principle in our discourse. A principle that raised the question, should the visual distinction between figures of ornament and the pure form of its host remain legible in architecture? Or in architecture, could there be a synthesis between the shaping of ornament and the shaping of construction? This is a very serious question. We sketched. We took great examples of ornament and concluded that ornament in architecture would be dysfunctional were it to lose its visual specificity by being blended or optically synthesized with a vital form of its host. If you make a puree out of a Sullivan project, you would destroy the contrast and tension which displays its power through a spectacle of interaction, figures 5 and 6. This is the same building, this is the famous Getty tomb. Ornament winding down through the various scales, all the way down to the hinge. He always, he would ornament elements. He would never allow the ornament to become the host object. He would go after parts. So if I, just even those friezes on the Vasseur arch, if I blended those with the Vasseur arch, I would lose the spectacle of interaction. But a spectacle of interaction did not, at least did not initially explain the peculiar and specific figuration typically illustrated in the encyclopedias dedicated to ornament. To investigate that interaction, we started by sorting out the things that were most usually, but not necessarily always ornamented, and concluded that they are often utilitarian, that is, things understood as possessing a conventional and practical purpose of their own, such as a hat, a spoon, a chair, or a facade, or an entryway. Ornament, thus, is a parergon, that is, an auxiliary to work. Structures like a dome or enclosures like a lobby already possess useful meanings that are embedded in everyday language, meanings to which the content of ornament can respond and take shape. A Rococo picture or mirror frame, next, is noteworthy in this in this respect. While the rocai figuration ornaments the surface of the frame, this is a mirror in one of the early lithographs in France that triggered the whole movement before it landed in architecture. The Rococo frame, while the rocai figuration, rocai being the sort of shell and leaf and rock forms that are running around the frame, ornaments the surface of the frame. The ornamented picture frame ornaments the picture inside the frame. Assume there's a picture in there or the clock. Even as, perhaps more importantly, the Rococo frame ornaments the surrounding wall. That final act may be its most active cause, although there is a powerful complicity between the rocai and the frame, the content of the frame, and the content of the frame. The entire arrangement is a decorative field, or we might just say a decorative arrangement. Decoration is meant to be well-mannered or a well-mannered or fashionable arrangement of things, of many things. Decoration also could also simply involve painting everything in the room white. So you could redecorate the thing on the right by painting it white. But the ornament is the figuration of ornament, and as I said, this is very late, would be the rocai around the perimeter of the frame. So you have to figure out how this pointer works. Again, I was explained to me. Wait. Whoops. This is not right. What am I doing wrong? Can you tell me how to do that? Yeah. Thank you. What do I push? All right, I pushed the top button. Okay. So I'm simply saying that here are the figures of ornament, but those figures are ornamenting the clock as well as the wall around them as well as the frame. Rokai is a relatively modern example of ornament. Figures of Rokai have a certain likeness from one setting to another. It's almost as though you can pull it off and carry it around. This implies that Rokai could be regarded as a species of autonomous figuration, although removal from its host would immediately negate its intended function, which is to ornament something. Thus, theoretically, the Rokai by itself is not ornament per se. There's a great section of the Chicago Institute of Fine Arts, which is their principal art museum, dedicated to ornament, in which they've gotten a lot of the Chicago ornament and hung it in the main entrance hall. It's an incredible room. But the buildings upon which and the places upon which that ornament existed is not there. So strictly speaking, you're looking at an exhibition of artifacts, not of ornament, because it's dysfunctional in that state, but it's still incredibly worth going to. Alois Riegel in Stillfragen, a seminal work in the modern theory of ornament, written about 1890, observed that for centuries the figuration of Western ornament was limited in its motifs and geometric kit of parts. Moreover, the same limited system of geometry and motifs served distinct techniques such as pottery, metalwork, fabric, and buildings. Next. What I'm saying here is that if you call this ornament, it's ornamenting this ceramic piece. In this case, it's ornamenting a metal helmet. Next. In this case, it's ornamenting a fabric. And in this case, the very same motif is ornamenting the dome in a Thracian tomb. So the specific figuration of ornament does not change by virtue of materiality, or even the object being ornamented. Riegel, pointing this out, disputed Gottfried Semper, who earlier in the century ventured a materialist explanation of ornament as a type of formation originally based on weaving. His observation also disputes the conceit that the craft of building could generate its own figures of ornament. It can, as Oliver so well said, allow ornament to happen, but the craft itself does not generate those figures. It became more and more evident that there must be explanations other than materiality, structural form, or even politics that have shaped the unique and persistent likenesses of a species of figuration considered to be ornament. Next, the linguist Eckhart Malatke, in his study of early human cultures, has described the pervasive existence of a universal and transculture of universal and transcultural figures of zigzags, repetitions, and patterns of dots. He is looking at these inside of other iconic material. He called them phosphenes. I don't know why, but he did. Something else happened. I keep pushing the wrong button. Why do I do that? Okay. Why does that thing blink? It's like the alarm on my boat. The drags and the anchor, thank you. Okay. Of transcultural zigzags that he found in all cultures all over the world in the earliest stages of their existence. He called them phosphenes, which he regarded as a kind of test pattern of the visual system. Perhaps we should allow that the dots and zigzags were a special property or instance of visual thinking, a category that was neither symbolic nor iconographic. I'll come back to this point. In Roland Barthes' words, quote, long before writing was invented, even before parietal writing, which means instruction giving, was practiced, something was produced which may fundamentally distinguish man from animal, the intentional reproduction of a rhythm. There have been found in cave walls of the Mysterian epoch certain rhythmic incisions, and everything suggests that these first rhythmic representations coincided with the first human inhabitations. In Henri Fauchelin's words, ornament was the first alphabet to come into contact with space. There is something spatial about this as compared to anything else on that wall. And this would be a later development beyond the phosphenes when these things begin to show up on tools and devices. The ancient origins of a type of rhythmized visual thinking matured into elegant geometric shapes in the classical moments of great world cultures. Such shapes are often described as keys. For the short talk, let's look at three sets of these keys which are seminal to the Greek, the Chinese, and the Mayan civilizations. Next. This would be your Greek key. This is the key extended into a repetitive pattern. This is a variation on it in which the circularity of the spiral is worked out with a rotor device. And this is a continuation of that one. What is interesting about the Greek key is that if you do this, which is their earliest version of it, you can soften it up organically, and it turns into a wave action. So it's something that actually does this. And this is very important when you get into comparative studies. Next. So the Greeks then would use that, as I pointed out earlier, on ceramics or in architecture, in these French interpretations of the Parthenon. Next. The Chinese key is different. It does this. So whereas one went like this, the other goes like that. It goes right, it goes left, it stops, right, left, stops, right, left, stops. I gave this lecture in China on the keys, and they were surprised that I was telling them that. You know, boom, boom. But in some ceremonies, you can see that even in their ceremonies, that comes into walking actions. So what happens with the Chinese key, as I'm calling it, when you extend it, or could you go back? When you extend it, it has this break in it, or it does it this way, and it has a break in it, et cetera, et cetera. If you do the sort of morphing of that, like I'm doing down here, it turns into the yin-yang, which is kind of interesting. So the Chinese use the key, but they always do a sequence of opposites. Next. And then they, too, bring it into their bronze work or into their architecture in a variety of specific ways. Next. This is the Mayan key. Or you can call it the Mexican, the Mayan key, which is the mature period of the Mexican civilization. It's often called the step and hook. And it seems to break up. It either works as a step and hook sequence or a hook sequence with all the hooks going the same way or a series of steps. Next. This, too, shows up in their artifacts. This is a stone yoke or in their architecture. So all these three supercultures, at the peak of their classical development, went from what Malatki was calling these phosphenes into these very mature key systems. Note that these classical keys have all employed the spiral, or the meander, if you prefer. In that respect, they are all extremely similar. They show the condensing and dilating spiral form, performing a variety of symmetry operations of translation, which is, or rotation, this way, reflection, that way, or zigzag. Those are all the basic symmetry operations that exist in Euclidean space, which is kind of interesting. So each of these cultures, and I've just mentioned three, we could go to any number, the African, the Indian, et cetera, the Polynesian. We'd find this same development going on at a certain point in their emergence as urban cultures. Indeed, the spiral meander, performing as a right or left-handed figure, became for thousands of years the most frequent auxiliary shape found in ornament distributed upon utilitarian objects. The ambivalence of the spiral is at the core of understanding ornament. But let me digress and examine other groups or types of visual activity. Why do I do that? What do I do? I'm an electronic illiterate. You have to push this one to turn that flasher off?
Yeah.
Okay, very good. I shouldn't play with it while I'm talking. At this moment, next, let me digress and ask another question that's central to the theory of ornament. By examining other groups or types of visual activity that are themselves somewhat isolated and clamoring for attention upon the same utilitarian object, and I'll choose more recent. For example, in this particular Renaissance print of the emperor, you have what I would, I'll jump and say ornament up here, but then how about this? This is lettering. How about this? This is a portrait. If we go over to this early building by Alexander Jackson Davis, you have a sculpture standing on top of the building. You have these books rammed into the pediment, and you have these dentals running along here, which indeed are rhythmic. And then you have this and this, and then you have these little pieces going out on either side of a bust. Which is ornament and which is not? After all, each group can be construed as auxiliary to the utilitarian form. This is a vexing problem. Should we include letterings and signs? Are symbols or portraits ornament? Or do they belong to other categories of visual language? And how do we analyze that problem? Critics of design, and you'll keep running into this, those of you who pursue ornament, wander somewhat carelessly from one group to another when they reference ornament. We can imagine all being somewhat ornamental, but the term ornamental is an adjective, not a substantive, and as such proposes qualities that may be found in ornament, but are not necessarily ornament per se. We could take that out of any other discipline. We could take sculpture, and we could say that a banyan tree is sculptural. Is it sculpture? We could say that the underside of a printed circuit is architecture, is architectural, but is it architecture? I'm asking the same question in relation to ornament and suggesting that that there is a distinction we have to make between the adjectival and the nominative. One answer, I believe, may arise, one answer to the question of which, may arise from analyzing certain conditions of dependency versus autonomy belonging to figures in different groups. Dependency allows a condition that ornament must intimately engage, or I could say, I don't have to even use the word ornament, that a figure must intimately engage the object being ornamented. It issues from a concrete necessity to interact in order to perform, to the point of seeming to be almost inseparable from its object. Consider that portraiture, picture, phonetic writing, signs, and symbols are all predetermined and conventionalized items that can easily be detached from something and still function, or indeed by design can be attached to anything by virtue of their portability, like lettering, or a price tag, or a logo in contemporary usage. Works of fine art, as an example, are usually capable of being moved from place to place for exhibit or temporary installation, unfettered by the visibly specific dependency on something else. They are self-sufficient. Yet the keys, and this would take more sit-down analysis to convince you, perhaps, yet the keys, with their acrobatic and ambivalent nature, once they are assembled into groups, in this case, would become lonely and peculiar doodles, wanting a clear function were they separated from their host. They would be aimless. Now, the ancient Greeks used the word chaos to mean unlimited. That order was by limiting something. I'll refer to this a little bit again. So that if you have a sequence of dots like those phosphenes, it would be considered, in the classical or pre-classical Greek sense, as a chaotic figure, precisely because it is not limited and congealed into a specific item. This peculiar feature of the keys provoked a harder look, especially to discern how they developed as figures over time. It appears that almost immediately, perhaps simultaneously, and we don't know the answer to this. I've tried it, scholars in Chinese, Greek, etc. There is no clear answer to this question, except for the fact that they seem to appear simultaneously. Well, they, It appears that immediately, perhaps simultaneously, that these keys became implicated with plants and animals from the field and forest. Next. I'll navigate this one. This is Riegel's argument that if you go back to the beginning of the formation of Egyptian ornament, there was a sequence of bud, blossom, bud, blossom, bud, blossom. It was a cycle. As the ornament developed, they actually wound it into a cyclic situation where the figure was a repetitive, very like the Greek key, but it was called a scroll because it comes to a finite ending. It doesn't have what the Greek has, which is going inside and then winding yourself out again. And then they put the lotus in as a zigzagging figure. So this, in Riegel's argument, was the development of the Egyptian proto-Greek ornament. Next. And here's what I mean. As these Greek keys were being developed, this kind of figuration was simultaneously occurring, where you have a lotus-enthymion, that is now tied together, not at first, but became tied together in the Greek excursus by these little scrolls with these leaves pushing off the top. The mature version of this, the mature classical version, was the lotus-enthymion motif performing in a zigzag with the scroll holding it together that way. Next. This particular formation, which I'm calling the foliated scroll, actually lived all the way into the 20th century and is still going. In interesting extreme versions like this Coptic ornament, the figure from the animal figure is actually quite independent, but thrown around by the action. In this 15th century Italian piece, there are animals in there, but they're metamorphoses. They're sprouting wings. They're not clear animals. Next. The scrolling appears in French medieval architecture in that period of literalism that Joan Evans and others talk about, Pevsner and the Leaves of Southwell. This is actually watercress, but it's watercress rolled into this repeating thing before it. And then this is, of course, Labruste ceiling where the scroll is still alive in the 19th century. Next. Going to the Chinese, a similar thing took place, except instead of using plants, they used the serpent. So that in this chow bowl, by the way, here's this little key piece that I was talking about. It goes and reverses, but it's also happening up here. But as it happens, the serpent gets involved. Here's the head of the serpent. Here's the head of the serpent. So the serpent, rather than the leaf, is rolled into the Chinese excursus. As time goes on, this is fairly late. This is a king, the last dynasty piece, in which these keys are now turned into cloud shapes. They've softened. In China, they'll call a hard key a thunder key and a softer key a cloud key, or a cloud, thunder and cloud. So they've attached specific readings to these things. But still, what's important in our research was to see that these keys remained intact, even in this very late stage, as the dragon began to appear. Next. Here's the dragon inflated into a Chinese, or subsumed in a Chinese bracket, and here's your key again, going like this. So the Chinese gather the life form into the key form. At the end, here's your dragon. I took this photograph of a Chinese dragon in Taipei, and it's a marvelous creature. It's all full. It has fish. It has all different kinds of animals tossed into the standing above a key form on a Confucian temple. So my point here is that the Greek key began to foliate, or to radiate foliation to become a foliated scroll, while a continuous and more curvaceous line work of the Chinese key combined with the serpent to become a serpentine scroll. The serpent qua dragon perdured as a motif in Chinese design to the present. If you've been watching the Olympics, you'd see it all over the place in painted walls. It was amazing. It was still there. to become a serpentine's crow. As the lotus, qua acanthus became the acanthus, qua conventionalized leaf or foliation perdured in the Western design for thousands of years. What can we make of such convergence with evocations of ants and planimals? Next.
Well, I just put these in as spectacular examples because here I show you two of the most outstanding conditions of ornament. This is Norwegian. The Norwegian used the serpent as well, the dragon. Scandinavians did. They weren't a lot, there was a little bit of this foliation going on. They used the spiral in joints, as the Chinese did on their tigers and lions, and built this wonderfully entangled entrance to the Ernest Stave Church. This piece on the right is Mexican, and it was done in the 18th century by native Mexicans who thought they were doing Baroque or early Chiragresque European stuff. That's what they were asked to do in this small chapel in Puebla. And here they have a three-dimensionalization of this scroll work, which is absolutely extraordinary. And here they have people, babies, with little flowers forms coming out of them as the metamorphic figure. It was interesting to me that this happened, that the Mexicans saw it that way and did it that way. And I would ask you to take a look at that one. It's in Puebla. Next.
What can we make of such convergence with evocations of animals and plants? Note the ambivalence and the metamorphic transformations from one state to another. They're metamorphoses. A metamorphose is something turning into another, which usually takes place in the animal or plant figure. Note the internal dependency of those natural apparitions with the geometry into which they are entangled. It evokes a galaxy of entanglements at all scales. In ornament, entanglement often is articulated as an interlace. With a few moments allowable in a single lecture, I must leap and surmise that while granting that there was an amount of symbolism in the serpent and the lotus, our predecessors were combining the organic geometry of living forms with the more fundamental symmetries registered in the ancient line work. It's curious that the most ancient is the most rigorously geometric, which shows up in all the 19th century encyclopedias, and then they become curvaceous and animated as they mature. That the living forms were combined with the more fundamental symmetries in order to achieve an all-pervading world picture. This rich combination made visible the formations of growth, contraction, mutation, and the cycles that they held as belonging to all of nature. For the ancients, those figures must have fulfilled their vision of a living universe. I'm going to leave a part out because I promised you I would move right along. It is noteworthy that neither the Chinese serpent nor the Western foliation was a portrait of a real animal. Consider the serpent more as a serpentine form than as a motif, evolved into the dragon, which is a figure morphed together from different types of animals. The radiating lotus and the palmette evolved into plant-like fractals, such as the acanthus or the protruding oak leaf of Sullivan. We cannot find those shapes in the zoo or the garden. Thus, the rhythmized dots and zigzags evolved into universal keys of life that I will call bio-keys, into which attributes of nature are compacted. These bio-keys not only manifest the energies of nature, they are the quintessence of nature that is presumed to exist everywhere. If I could tweak our habitual way of thinking a little, I would argue that when we pay close attention to them, they appear to be nature swimming in the mind's eye, especially this one. If you stare at that for any length of time, which I did, you are actually transformed. Such turbulence contrasts with the things being ornamented, which are limited, temporary, and formalized into conventional identities and specific man-made shapes and artifacts. What I'm saying here is that, yes, you have all of this cosmos, these bio keys, but they're locked into the stability of the artifact so that while they're in motion, the artifact contains them. We can discern here
an opposition between the natural and the man-made, an interlaced opposition. How, we might ask, did the ancients envision the world a long time ago when the keys originated? Certainly the keys were formulated prior to the emergence of the concept of abstraction as we know it. I don't think you can use the word abstract here. A concept in the history of Western art and architecture which was most radically exercised in the last century. Compelling arguments in anthropology and hermeneutic studies and philosophy have pointed to animism and concrete body thinking as agents of reality in the designs of antiquity. During the formation of classical Western culture, as revealed by the musings of the 7th and 5th centuries pre-Socratic philosophers, there were strands of belief in an animated cosmos or universe. I'm going to leave some of that out because I'm going to try to get you through this a little faster so that we can have a discussion. What I was about to say is that if you read the pre-Socratic philosophers, you can get an explanation for this. If you read Thales or Anaximander, for example, I'll talk about Anaximander. Writing in the 6th century BC, noted as a geographer and astronomer, viewed the cosmos, and I told you that ornament was in the Greek, which doesn't have the word, conflated into the word cosmos, the category that did this found its way into the word cosmos. Anaximander was a geographer and astronomer, viewed the cosmos as a boundless whole, subject to winds of Apeiron, a condition of all-pervading motion that scattered oppositions into the one. Next. I got the first person who used the word Apeiron in this discussion is Bernard Cash, whom I know lectures here, so I have to give him credit for introducing me to that idea. But then I went and I read Anaximander to see what he was doing with it. And he was basically saying, well, you know, there is this motion that is everywhere, and these opposites float around inside of it, and they try to get together, but Apeiron drives them apart, keeps them moving. And the perpetual motion of these things disallowed one to triumph over the other, as the power of Apeiron was ageless and indestructible. This was a pre-scientific thesis that remained beholden to a driving force. It was a subsequent effort to conceive the means of ordering such unlimited chaos that inspired Plato to declare the wisdom of categorizing things under discrete rational forms that could organize our thinking, like the cubes and icosahedrons that organize our spatial thinking and geometry. Taking into account that those ancient musings still remain on the table today, we haven't eliminated that, which is very interesting. We really don't know what is driving our system. In any case, all of that aside, what does cosmos and what does Apeiron and its marshalling of ambivalence have to do with my suggestion that a condition of dependency is the ground upon which we might single out the ornament group from the others that possess more autonomous types of figures such as signs, symbols, lettering, and portraiture? Next. When I go back, I think this is the same thing. Here's a building with clear writing, autonomous figurations, these dentils, these brackets, which, by the way, John Summerson, in a great article in 1975, said is not ornament, but in fact, despite its rhythm, is an architectural detail belonging directly to the trajectory of architecture. The ornament is more, in what I'm discussing, found in these areas and in these areas. This is what I'm getting to. So how does my suggestion that a condition of dependency is the ground upon which we might single out the ornament group from the others that possess more autonomous types of figuration, such as signs, symbols, lettering, and portraiture? The answer, I believe, is that only within the distinct province of ornament is the visual figuration predicated upon a nascent, active, and intentional unwillingness to be contained or to congeal into an independent, stable formation. That active unwillingness fuels a virtual choice machine, a machine that willfully articulates and privileges a procedure of endless choice making, of repetition, changefulness, and transformation over shape resolution. Next two figures. Such an activity per se may reveal the most essential feature within the figuration of ornament, which is to present an intelligent indeterminacy, while simultaneously hoarding all the symmetry operations known to govern Euclidean matter. That's a very interesting phenomenon, because we found that these symmetry operations that ornament hoarded were in fact highly intelligent. They were carefully worked out. They were not easily arrived at. It took culture thousands of years to get them organized. Yet, with all of that, they remained in a state of unwillingness to congeal by their very nature. Indeed, ornament's rich portfolio of symmetry operations is capable of visually manifesting all the playful variety of forces believed to exist both outside and inside the thing being ornamented. In this way, the stuff of ornament presumes to exist everywhere, at any time and in any vector of the world. Its ubiquitous, capricious, and unconstrained potentials, its living cosmos, is illuminated, or we might say respected, only by its encounter with the overwhelming formal authority of the particular host upon which it must depend. That is, the specific, limited, and constrained thing, like a statement or a place of an entrance next to. Here I'm simply suggesting that in this page on the left, the ornament is approaching the certainty of the writing, and it is prevented from advancing, and vice versa. On Sullivan's entrance to the great Carson Perry Scott building, the ornament wants to escape, but it's prevented by the colonnettes on either side and the arches on the bottom. In the edges of that encounter, ornament succeeds in illuminating its host by colliding with discrete and determinate visible form. And in turn, the host magnifies the ornament by resisting its mercurial antics. Both ornament and its host become more brilliant. Unconstrained, next. The elements of ornament are even capable of breaking boundaries or scattering as they sometimes do, for example, in the late Rococo, next. Or these close examinations of Sullivan's work where these kind of escape artistry of the ornament is found over and over again. It is noteworthy that ornament in great public architecture has been the norm for all of recorded history. Evidently, it has been traditionally regarded as a natural article of visual language and expression. If we arbitrarily pick a date late in the advent of human urban culture, say 4000 BC, and I pick up here on what Oliver was saying in the introduction, then ornament's rhetoric has been an important agenda in the articulation of urban space for at least 6000 years. The prohibition or obfuscation of ornament in the recent Academy of Modernist Design is the most clearly registered by its removal from the curriculum. You know, this is an important point, because those who say, well, we didn't remove it, then I say, well, why did you take it out of the curriculum? Why is there no literature on the shelf? That's the proof that I could use in court if I had to. And may yet, but I don't think I have to, with people like Oliver coming online. its removal from the curriculum has been enforced only since the end of World War II, during which time its mention was often mocked. Measured this way, the 20th century abandonment of ornament in the academy involves less than 1/100th of the chronological history of architecture, if we consider its urban phase. And I must emphasize that it was a true banishment. I just sort of said that. You can't say that it was its absence, its presence was in its absence. You can't get away with that. It was not there for the reasons I said, although there were definitely subcurrents going on. In the centuries after the French Revolution, architecture has produced magnificent and publicly treasured examples of ornament regardless of political, financial, or cultural differences between regions and nations. Ornament in modernity has no more to do with politics than bread, water, stone, or sunlight. I have suggested in my capsule history of ornament that its rhythmic roots can be traced to the beginning of human time. Therefore, I believe it is safe for me to surmise that ornament is a natural and sustainable part of human thought and language that has been continually understood and only recently repressed. If you talk to musicians about this, most musicians will say that the question of ornament barely has to be asked because all musicians more or less knew what it was until it was overtly. Again, in the middle of the late 20th century, there were theoretical attempts to pull it from compositional teaching, the same as in architecture. And so I was simply saying that it's a natural and sustainable part of human thought and language that has been continually understood. It is a particular species of thought, a species among species of visual thinking and rhetoric. Let me digress for a moment and consider the 20th century ordinance. I'm going to go through this one very quickly. The purity of space without ornament. Next. I'm looking at my clock. I was just saying here that claims could be made that in our contemplation of space, and Bachelard, Guest and Bachelard talks about this, in the contemplation of pure space, you could achieve the phenomenon of intimate immensity. He suggests how we can be reminded of the world at large as the consequence of being within a sensitive ordering of space, a recollection that might itself generate an image of enlargement. Some unornamented 20th century architecture has indeed articulated immensity. If we can combine the word immensity with cosmos, which I don't think we can do, but I'm saying it anyhow, by the brilliant fine-tuning of the spatial edges, openings, and escapes from interiors. Such tuning can choreograph the corporeal sense of grandeur in passages of light and can do so within the medium of pure variegated white space sculpted by an arrangement of plain walls. The medium of pure space in concert with light is truly remarkable in its management of the sublime, fueled by the fact that it is essentially a condition of emptiness. The intricacy of ornament, on the other hand, has always proclaimed or recalled immensity in an entirely different way. It does so by delivering a rich and active figuration that registers an essential fullness, indeed a concentration of stuff. It can perform in comparatively dark settings as easily as one's flooded with light. Next. This is one of my favorite comparisons. I'll admit there's a certain extremism in this choice, but I was able to photograph these two churches because in Mexico they built them all the same. They were built in the 18th century and they had domes and pendentives and tops and bottoms. And you will find this one in one village, but this one, like the Capillo piece I showed you earlier, was designed by native Mexicans. They built it south of Cholula. It's called Tonantzitla. It too can generate an image of enlargement. That's my point. Pure spatial form per se is by definition immaterial and happens in architecture only because it is defined or molded by material surface. Ornament performing as the stuff of everything is found within the material surface and yet is no less capable of contributing to the spectacle of immensity by presuming that a turbulent and compacted cosmos pervades everything and is everything. These two means of expressing immensity, one beholden to presenting a pure, unfettered space of emptiness, and the other filling emptiness with coherent notions of everything, can be opposed if taken to the extremes. Ornament resists ubiquitous whiteness and the cast white light that seems to sanitize the physical world. I grant that both mean to architecturally transport us beyond the limitations of contained volume. Although ornament does so within the anatomy of its own fabric. Next. If I had time, I would show you these close-ups, but I don't. Next. Is that the next one? Yeah. Is that six? Yeah. As I declared early on, ornament is not independent and must be a part of a larger whole. It can be a part of a part of a part. I could have chosen any number of examples, but I chose the Grand Palais by Garault, 1901 in Paris, just to say that here's your ornament right in through here. But when you get away from that, you have conventional structure. Next. Can you go back to, I think I had another one in there on the Grand Palais. Here I am saying that much of what you see here, the top, these walls, this is the Sarah show, are conventional. Web trusses, glazed canopy, white walls, normal conventional fences. And then the ornament appears only in tiny moments of transition. Next. Here, up close. Or in their stare. Okay. Ornament must belong to a complex system of composition as an agent of transformation. This is the main staircase. It flourishes in topographies usually found in liminal portions of its object, such as edges in pottery, picture frames, joints, windows, roofs, and entryways. This is a Chinese window. The Chinese mastered the phenomenon of looking at vistas through ornament, and this goes back to their key systems, so that your vision of nature is mediated by these edges. And they actually change your vision of what's outside. It gains strength in interstitial space, in zones of transition where it can be figuration upon multiple grounds. It can capture, surround, and contain bits and pieces of things and information such as icons, specific faces, vistas, local plants and animals, words and letters in illuminated manuscripts and numbers, etc., etc., as it manifests a play of connections between otherwise disparate pieces. The practical necessity, and here I get to the word necessity, is evident in basic economics. Ornament is a portion of a decorative field that performs at its best when the portion being ornamented is much larger, and the utilitarian identity of that larger portion remains legible. Such elements, when carefully proportioned, can fuel ornament. In architecture, a building suitable for ornament can afford to be quite ordinary and comfortably resolved, like a well-organized auditorium, lobby, or an elevation subject to rigorous building codes of setback and height, with practical openings for light and air, commanding forms. The commanding forms of ornamented buildings do not have to gyrate or be extraordinary objects of modern artistry. The basic utilitarian forms to be ornamented can be governed by economics of cost, program, sustainability, and the imperatives of urban design. Bereft of ornament, they can even be boring. Ornament, by its internally thick and rhythmic constitution, flourishes on objects and buildings that have direct, simple, and conventional identities. Let's visit Sullivan in this respect. Next. The small bank in Grinnell, this was a budget work towards the end of his life, was a low budget project in which few subordinate elements were ornamented and the building remained a simple box, so the ornament was concentrated here along his edges and around the clock. His large urban projects provided lessons in distributing ornament that can be seen. Next, the Wainwright Building in St. Louis, considered by Vincent Scully to be the proto-skyscraper in America, reaches the crescendo by ornamenting the attic. An idea rooted in the classical triad of base, shaft, and pediment. But today's modern public pays scant attention to details that far up, except in magazines. Next. In the Guarantee Building, here's your top. This is one of the great foliated scrolls, and this was a 20th century accomplishment. Next. In the Guarantee Building in Buffalo, which came after that one, Sullivan effectively ornamented the entire surface of the building by wrapping it in a skin of consistently ornamented elements. Next. It is magnificent, well built, but it is uneconomical. Next. The Carson Perry department store, with its offices above, got it right. The most powerful and turbulent ornament occurs at the corner entrance, at street level. The base is ornament, next. The base is ornamented to the mezzanine course, right here. Next. The window frames or reveals in the upper portion of the building are ornamented so that one can look through a portal of figuration from the interior. And the topmost level next, recently restored. You can't find this one in books. They're just finishing. They put it back on. I got that photograph a couple of months ago at the top. The topmost level, which I said earlier, is probably not going to be seen by most people. It belongs to its privileged occupants. So this is the end of my theoretical text.
And I would like to show you some selected examples of my own studio over the years. I think I have time for that. Okay. Because we started a few minutes late. I hope they will demonstrate at least my effort to combine theory with practice. Most of the work was realized in teamwork between building designers, ornament designers, and clients. I will move rapidly so that we can open time for discussion, and then I can return to any image you wish. Next. This was my, I think I showed you, this was in 1964. This was my first effort at this motion on surface. Next.
Another series, and I wasn't really conscious of ornament at this time, was the effort to put sculpture, what I was calling sculpture, inside of these planes that I thought established a kind of dyad that worked better than either of them being autonomous.
Next.
I tried to put that one into, I got a project and put that idea into a lobby in the 70s. I'm happy to say that the building was virtually torn down and rebuilt, but they saved this. So I had the honor of being resurrected. They thought they couldn't get rid of it. And that happened about 3 years ago. Next. Then I did this bizarre project in New Orleans during the New Orleans World Exhibition, where I tried to use the stable object and these leaves flying around. That turned into an ice cream stand as the funds for continuing the World Exposition were declining, and they needed to get more revenue. Next. This was my largest job, which was the top of the Chicago Library, which involved this, all of this, following the notion of the foliated scroll, this railing. And there's one thing I'd like you to at least note about this. Clearly, in some respect, it could be called a Beaux-Arts project, but I promise you, the Beaux-Arts was not able to stand that stuff on glass. These things are mounted on a curtain wall, as you can see. And this happens, there are seven of these. This is about, I forget now, 300 some odd feet, and then it goes 175 feet. There are seven of these, 40 feet from here to here. Next.
This was a job that I did. I do have dates for these, if it matters, in the airport in Washington,
which reminded me a little bit of what I saw in Paddington Station, which I absolutely loved coming in the day before yesterday, that screen they have at the end, using ornament on a curtain wall in a thoroughly modern technology of building. Some of this, by the way, Oliver, was done by CNC, and some of it by hand.
Next.
This was a project I got, let's see, when, in 1997, where an architect in Denver had designed this building in the sort of Western stockade style to go over Interstate 80. This is 325 feet from here to here, in Kearney, Nebraska, which is halfway between the Atlantic and the Pacific. And this road here was the Oregon Trail, and this was considered, this is the most trafficked road in the Western Hemisphere. It was during the opening of the West and still is. The amount of traffic going through is 75 miles an hour. A local sort of patron wanted to put two huge cowboys on either side of the building, sort of welcoming people to the West. So the architects said, come out, fly to Denver, you've got to get in on this one. So we managed to get rid of the cowboys, and I put this thing running, because if this is the connection between the East and the West Coast of the USA, why not make a connection? That sort of says that, but what I really wanted to do was design this stuff and make a straightaway. And then since they wanted an icon, we made a horse jumping out of it. Next. The business of icons is kind of interesting. When you get a large commission to do ornaments, because we now practice as ornamenters and we get called all the time, groups generally want us to produce iconography, and we have to point out that that's not a good idea. Let us do the ornament. This is a staircase that I designed the house and put the staircase in. This is the notion of concentrating ornament in one element, like Sullivan did. Next. Likewise, this was a gate we did recently for a new building at Yale, where the ornament, this was their new chemistry building, and we said, can we put the chemistry, again, they started with iconography. This is inorganic tetrahedrons, organic. These are peptides that spell Yale Chem in peptide language, which has series of molecules. And this one is an icing lattice designed by a Nobel laureate, Ostanger, a Norwegian, a professor at Yale, who describes the transition of solid states from, say, water to steam or ice to water in a formula. And we got the formula, we read it, and we visualized it to use as a centerpiece. So this is full of rationales for the committee. Next. And this is our latest project, which is, we broke ground last week. This building, do you see these trees up here? They're going to be there, but actually what's up there is a 32-story tower in downtown New Haven. New Haven desperately needs more rentable space because, like in many towns in America, any city, that if you lose your residence, you lose the city. So the city bought a destroyed block on their main street and put it out for developers or architects to come up with the money and the way to build this, for which they would give them the land. And the person who got this figured out that he had to put this tower 60 feet behind this edge, and that he found out in reading the small print that he had to park 500 cars. The 500 cars, he couldn't go down. He couldn't go down because New Haven is a waterfront town, and there is a water shelf down here full of hazardous materials. So the cost of cleaning that up and docking it was way beyond the budget. So he had to go up. Then the town said, well, you can't put a parking garage on Chapel Street. It's our Chapel Street. So then he called me up. And I said, well, what would you do? So what we did was we designed this, and it was accepted. It's under construction. This hasn't been designed. These are all placeholders. But we wrapped the base of the building the same way Sullivan did, with a continuous frieze that is masonry from here to here. Then it turns into metal as it goes around the corner. These are stair towers. And we built these foliated trellises, you can see it here, that go up in the air. In fact, juniper is going to come pouring over these edges and down the side of these troughs. So this whole area will be an elevated garden. And then the tree is behind it. Next. The bottom of that building, it's fun because we got control of 575 feet of New Haven. That's the end of my talk. Are there any questions? I didn't run that far over because I tried to stay within an hour, and we started about an hour late. I think I almost did it. I left out a little bit of philosophical musing. Are there any questions that I could answer? Yes.
Your image 48, critically on a building, you describe the kind of flim-flam at the bottom as being ornament.
You describe the flim-flam at the bottom of the
image
top
48.
Of the portal.
Can we pull image 48? Nick?
Yeah.
Can you get us image 48?
It's really just a question of what do you call the rest? Is it symbol, because whatever grace and truth or whatever banks used to put on their front doors to show what probity they had, and the portal to show it's a front door. Are those symbols to you rather than ornament?
I'm trying to find image 48. Okay, up there. You mean this?
No.
It was the French Credit Lyonnais Bank.
The
head of the door. It was the head of the door. There were kind of a couple of statues.
Oh! You mean the one? Okay, that was the one where I showed the figures and the lettering.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's find that one. That would be. Okay, well, what is your question? I think we're
the question is, you describe the kind of flim-flam at the bottom of the image as being ornament.
Yes. How do I get there?
No, what do you call the rest?
Well, I would call this lettering.
Yes.
I would call this autonomous sculpture.
Right.
I would call this architectural detailing that is conventional to architectural detailing. For example, there are books that you can get out of libraries on moldings that claim to be ornament. And what they do is they take a section through the molding, and it may have a seam of reversa or some such thing on it, and they declare that because of doing this, it is ornament. Summerson disputed that in Via 3 in a very brilliant short article he wrote called What is Ornament and What is Not? And he took out moldings and ribs of, for example, the ribs in a Gothic cathedral, which are not necessary, et cetera, et cetera. And he removed all of those and said they are conventional architectural details that should not be called ornament, which he granted had this capacity of coming in from without.
Fine, just because you don't need any of that to actually show where the door is.
So what?
You don't need any of that stuff that's there to show, A, that it's a bank, and B, that
no,
it's
you
where
don't
the door
need
is.
It at all. It's in fact, the function of ornament, the rhetoric, that's why I was mentioning that ornament should not be necessarily analyzed from the standpoint of iconography or symbolism. Precisely because one of the strategies we used in our investigation, I say it's a long going one, is we asked the question, and this is an oblique question, what can we find on a building or on traditional buildings that has in fact been removed and declared something else overtly? For example, sculpture. Carson Harry's book, have you seen that yeah. remarkable book on the Rococo church? He's one of the great theoreticians of ornament. I disagree with him on this. He said that the Rococo, and this goes back to the Café Neuhaus that you've mentioned, Oliver, could be taken off the building, could be ripped off the building. Mm-hmm. If it's ripped off the building, what happened to it? And he argued that it became modern art. It became modern sculpture. It was the prototype of organic modern sculpture. But he didn't. What we did was we re-examined anything that could be taken off the building that could exist in an autonomous life, and took it off the list. That was our method. It was a pruning. Therefore, any symbol that was fundamentally autonomous, and this gets into a lot of Buddhist architecture. It's kind of interesting, and that doesn't qualify an ornament. Not as much as Chinese. The Chinese stuff remains ornament no matter how you cut it. Although it's funny, since the Chinese don't have a word for ornament, and I've lectured in China, and they really struggle with this one. They kind of understand it. They don't know quite what I'm talking about, but then they go ahead and do it anyhow. Because I think it's mixed into their language, into their way of picture languaging or visual languaging, that the Chinese do speak, do have a visual alphabet. And they will give you little names of what I'm talking about, and the names are the right names, but they don't call it ornament. So basically, we took off anything that could be taken off and asked ourselves, what could be left behind that was dependent on a stationary object for its existence, such as, for example, the foliation on these festoons. If they were pulled off, they would be chaotic. It's the fact that they're festooned and held by those rings. If this emblem were taken off, it could survive. If these guys were taken off, they couldn't, within our argument.
Well, I don't know, but by the time that building was constructed, you didn't actually need columns and
right, of
cornices
course.
And stuff.
Of course not, yeah. Yeah, and again, Summerson would grant that a pilaster is an element of architecture. Which, yeah, sure. Are there any other questions? Did I succeed in any way in suggesting that ornament was necessary? Yes?
Two questions.
Yes.
One, at the very beginning, you mentioned about the renaissance of ornaments.
The what?
Renaissance.
Yes. That was Oliver, yeah.
Oh, okay, sorry. Do you
about that?
Yeah, where are we going? And another question, that the what's the effect of an ornament for us over how we experience the space or the feelings and the emotions of the effect of the ornament, if there is any?
Okay, well, starting with the first question, what's happening to us, since we're the only studio on the East Coast that calls ourselves ornamenters, and when people hire us, they have to put our name on their letterhead, along with the structural engineers, the lighting engineers, the environmental specialists, the lead crowd, all of it. Boom, 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 ornamenters, Bloomer Studio, boom, boom, boom. So that's been accepted. We can now, on the East Coast, my experience is with the group I'm working with, that they will hire us to do that. So that could not have happened 10 years ago. They would have thought we were wacky. And furthermore, to the extent that we do it, they could not have imagined it as a discipline, as something that involved knowledge per se. Because ornament was thought of in these other generalities, in these removable items, which, by the way, is the reason why we have to go after the removable items. Otherwise, they'll hire a graphic designer or a lettering expert. They'll take it away from you, whether you're an ornamenter or an architect. I mean, look at the stuff that's already been taken away from architects. If you look at large projects and look at them at the number of sub-disciplines that the architect is almost has to include, structural engineering being one of the most glaring. Unless you have a huge office, you've got to consult all those things. So that what's happening in our studio is we're past that point. That is a break in the weather. In where I come from, which is the New England, New York part of the states. And that's spreading. I have students now that are coming to me and wanting to be apprenticed for that. And they're MArchs. They're not coming from the art schools. The art schools are more interested in self-expression. And when they face the fact that's not part of what we do. They'll take a summer job and they're out of there. The architects who have already been trained that you're working for the city and the client and the environment don't see that as an issue. Now, going to your next question, which is much more difficult to answer, I tried to answer that a little bit when I showed the comparison between the two churches in Mexico, and I talked about the unornamented versus the ornamented. And I was suggesting that the spatial issue was just as active in the ornamented as it was in the unornamented. That we shouldn't be thinking of space in a sanitized way. It's not white. Space is essentially emptiness. That's what the word means. You can talk your head off about space, and space is an important topic. But you've got to pin down what you're talking about. Are you talking about room for function? What are you talking about? Now, if you're you brought up the idea of feeling. As I said, this is a radical example. By the way, that church was in great disrepair around before the First World War, and a German explorer walked in there. He saw it, and he saw to it that the thing was fully restored. He got money from international sources, and this thing was put back together again. I've been there several times. When I go to Mexico, I always go over there. It is not as, what's the word I should use? It is not as horrendous as it appears to be. So when you talk to me about the feelings you get, one thing I mentioned, and again, this is an extreme example, then I'll go to the Grand Palais and try to answer it there. Or to the Chinese windows. I tried several examples, but let's stay here for a moment. What you do in a place like this is you go inward, a little bit like you do in Islamic. The way to read Islamic ornament is to go into the microcosm. That's what it's really about. It sort of jumps between the microcosm and the stars. So you have to ask yourself where you want to go with your feelings.
the more you look at ornament, the more I look at it, the more I'm anxious to take those mental journeys. And I have an enormous respect for Islamic work in that respect, because it takes you into the microcosm. This does as well. Next, I can show you a couple slides. The Chinese, this is a close-up. Perhaps you'd, if you'd like to spend a second looking at it. Here's your scroll work. Do you see? It's all over the place. These hooks, it's full of these hooks that I call the hook and the step motif. But these Native Americans, Native Mexicans, and by the way, Malachi's work were Native Americans, if you call the United States America, it's all America. And this is Native Mexican. They thought that they were doing what they were supposed to do, and they put the scrolls in, which they already knew about. But then they filled every possible intricacy with a head. Here's St. Luke that got in because there was obviously a parish priest involved. But for the most part, this is a world of heads. And it's going to take me more time and more examples. But if you look at this for any great length of time, what they do in this small church is called Tonanzitna, which is in Nahuatl. Nahuatl is Native Mexican language for little woman. You go in there, and you can see how it's defying the European concept of heaven and earth. They singularize the world into a womb, into the mother, which also North American natives do too, because the sacred world is below or inside the mother. It's not up in the stars. That's very European, to things up in the air like ballet dancing. In the America, traditional America, the sort of places you want to go to are either down into the ground or into the mother. And this is the mother. So again, the feelings that you generate from this, I was able to generate my responses without that knowledge I just divulged. I didn't know what this was all about, and I have enough friends in Mexico that helped me break it down, people who know Nahuatl. We found out what it was. But keep going to the Grand Palais. I would feel differently about this building if this wasn't here. I'll talk about feeling. When I see this building, when I see it, I go to there and there. I go to the points of transition. Those are the places where I get my greatest feeling, is to go towards interstitial space. And ornament is all about that. It's all about the dynamic of metamorphose. So if you're looking for or respond to, as gardeners do, and many naturalists, to a world that is constantly having a birth-death cycle, a cycle of growth and mutation, you'll find that and all the feelings that attend that in ornament. And you won't find it in sanitized white space. Are there any more questions? Yeah.
Traditional architecture and or old architecture and modern architecture is pretty profound. How do we begin to bridge that gap, and like what's to do?
I'll give you my answer. It's the same answer that was given to me by a theorist of music, a theorist of jazz, a great scholar at Yale named Willie Ruff, who's a jazz musician from Alabama. He said, you go to the beginning. I think that you have to get away from chronological provincialism. You cannot stay contemporary and understand ornament. You can get to the contemporary, but you have to go back to the beginning. I find this over and over again. For a long period of time, I stopped. I went back to about the French Revolution to see what happened after that. I even left the Renaissance out. And I couldn't get as far as I wanted to go. That's why I've gone all the way back. In fact, I have an article at home of Neanderthal ornament. The Neanderthals, according to some latest findings, had body ornament that was very beautiful. So I think to understand ornament, you have to go back to the beginning and track yourself through its history. That's not easy. That's what we've been doing in our seminar. But we didn't know how to do it. We didn't know what to pin ourselves down to. That's why I said the first thing we had to pin ourselves down to was the dyad. Then later on, we got onto issues such as, the apparent fact that the stuff that was emerging seemed to be these choice machines that didn't want to congeal. You have to have those questions in your pocket, and then start looking. And above all, you have to get out from under the provincialism of modernism. Modernism is extremely important, obviously, and I love a lot of architecture built under the name modernism, but it is nevertheless a style and a provincial style. It occurred in a very clear period of time. There's no reason why you or anybody in this room should confine yourself to that period. Ornament. If you read any of the great encyclopedias of ornament, and this helped us, for example, Owen Jones or Racinet or Regal, the 19th century was a period of immense theorizing about ornament, and that's when the ornament encyclopedias appeared. Dolmetsch in Germany, Racinet and Owen Jones in London, Semper and so on. You'll find that all of them went back to the beginning. All of them went back to the earliest work, the sort of phosphenes that Malotki was talking about, and then they came back to where we are. And what's interesting to me is that the people who studied ornament, for the most part, are not time provincial. They don't limit themselves to the problem of modernism. Almost to the Gombrich, I could go on. I could give you the Hall of Fame of people who've written about ornament, and you'll see that they all went back to the beginning. And I think the reason for that is because ornament, as I claimed in the talk, is a natural language. And they know, as I now know, that ornament, for being a natural language, was always understood until it was repressed. You didn't have to write a treatise on ornament at one time. It was part of visual rhetoric. You know, you get ornament and it acts in relationship to something else. It's a conversation. And if you know how that conversation works, because it's part of your life, then you'll see it every time it comes in front of your eyes. But A, if you don't know how it works, and B, if you're told not to look at it. For example, when I was a student at MIT, this will date me, I studied architecture in the late 50s. And I remember the first time I heard of the Carson Peary Scott building by Sullivan. The professor put a picture of the Carson Peary Scott building on the wall, and then he cranked it such a way that the bottom two floors came off the screen. He said, "You're to look at this building, but don't look at the bottom. I'll take it off for you so as not to contaminate you." And then I didn't realize that all those reveals in that white surface that he was trying to show us were in fact ornamented. I didn't realize it until I went to Chicago and saw the Monadnock building. The Monadnock building, which I think all of you know, is that great building that swoops up like this. And that's all we ever heard about it. It's a building that's a 20-story building that is made of stone, wall-bearing stone brick. So it has to be 6 feet wide to get into the first floor, and it tapers in. And this is what we were told to look at. So I went there, I looked at it, and then I got inside and went up and looked out a window. And I saw that all the reveals of the window were ornamented. And I said, why didn't they tell us that? Because if you're in the building, that's what you're looking through, just like the Chinese screens. And then when we went to Carson Peary Scott, we found the same thing. I don't know whether I've answered your question, except I would suggest that you look, well, there's Oliver, you have him, and he'll take you to all sorts of exciting places. I think one of the things that Oliver said at the beginning was that a very important problem in ornament, and my students have said this exact same thing. That's the upper part, right. The problem of labor in ornament
was traditionally a severe problem. We are actually a manual shop. We have been a manual shop since 1964, although about 20 years ago we started using CNC for a lot of the work. We're using water jet, we're using, you know, CNC-driven benders, large projects, etc. But we're not relying 100% on CNC. What we're still doing is hybridizing hand with CNC cut parts so that they do that and then we do this. But it's true, it's absolutely true that the labor factor was a forbidding one. And the immediate response was that because of the labor factor, you can't afford ornament. Or the laborer doesn't exist. Even if they existed, they would tell us, you can't afford it because they don't exist. We say, I know one. And they'll say, no, that's not possible. Or if it does, he's probably expensive. And that's not true. None of that's true. But what Oliver is pointing out is that with the tools we have now, and here you are in your in your studios, in your classrooms, and you have equipment here, you can start working on shapes and things that 10 or 15 years ago we couldn't have gone near. And I think the production of ornament digitally is going to develop enormously over your period of time. And there's one more thing about the labor problem. It was used as a political thing. You know, the exploitation of the worker. Well, that's ridiculous. Most of the workers that we've run across would love to do ornament. They couldn't do it at a massive scale, but they'd rather do that than lay brick all day or you know, put in drywall all day or run wires all day. It gives them a life. That's Ruskin's argument in the lap of labor. Are there any more questions? Yeah? Would you say that? I have a slight hearing problem, probably because I've been banging too much.
Is this working?
I'll put my hearing aid on if you don't mind. I was a drummer in a jazz band, and I knocked out that whole range. But otherwise, I'm fine.
Test. Okay. I was interested in the idea of the phosphemes.
Phosphemes is Malachi's word, and I've read his books, and an article was written on them. I haven't called him yet. I was going to call him before I came over here. But what I think happened to Malachi was Malachi is a linguist. He was trained as a linguist. He's also a photographer. And he fell in love with the with a part of the United States that was occupied by the Navajos, the Utes, the Hopis, which is sort of the Arizona-New Mexico area. There are lots of hills there. And he discovered these incredible cave things. Some of them aren't on caves, they're on the side of cliffs because it's a dry area. Some of them go back 8,000 years. He started photographing them. And as a linguist, what he did was he went to his art historian friends. This is what it sounds like from reading his books. It sounds like he went to his art historian's friends who told them that he had to find what they meant. And he couldn't. I mean, if you found a turtle, you know, or something that they could tie into some knowledge of the mythology of the Utes or something like that, he would say, well, this means so-and-so. But he couldn't figure out what these other things meant. And it was interesting to read some of his articles because he said, they are not symbols. There's something else. And I give him a lot for that because I don't think he went to the right sources. This is why we're going to try to get in touch with him. If he had gone to something as simple as Owen Jones, and read the beginning pages, he would have seen what he's talking about because Owen Jones was aware of them. So was Semper. Semper's brother used to go out to the South Pacific and look at all sorts of very early ornament. But for some reason, Malachi hasn't done that. I think that he's been told that, or nobody has informed him that that's the place he should go to figure out what he's trying to figure out, but he did. What was amazing is that on his own, he figured out that these were non-symbolic, that they were not, they didn't belong to picture language. He noticed that they were, in some version, he said they were their aesthetic somehow. And then finally he came up with the idea that, well, they seem to have to do with thinking. And he thought that it was a form of thinking. And I agree with him. Any of you who have sat down and doodled know that you're thinking when you put dots down. So Malarkey got to the point of recognizing that he was looking at a type of natural language. And I think he's important because of his credentials in linguistics and symbolism. Does that answer your question? Or I didn't know whether I beat around the bush on that one.
That was interesting. I didn't actually ask the question yet. I was interested in the way you described it as a test pattern of the visual system. Yeah. That's him again, I guess, his terminology.
He used the word phosphine. I don't know. I think he invented it. I think he was sitting down with some friends of his drinking beer or something. And he came up with phosphine. He's got to find it anyplace else. But since he was the only person who did it, why not? That's fine. Okay, they're phosphines. So I'm still not answering your question.
Okay, don't worry. But like when you push your hands into your eyeballs.
Oh, yeah, why was it visual? Go on.
Okay. When you push your hands into your eyeballs, you do get these kind of zigzags and dot patterns emerging.
Right.
And I was wondering if there is something kind of inbuilt biological about the patterns that emerge.
Yes. I see where you're going. Yeah. We're going there too. There's an institute in Canada at McGill that has been very good at examining mental patterns in audio perception, and they're starting to work in the visual realm with neuroscientific tools. And I think that is where we're going to get answers beyond the ones we have now, to see whether they're whether this natural language is in fact accompanied by natural proclivities, and in what part of the brain are they working, which is where all this stuff is going. In music, they are, you know, in brain scanning, they now go from one sector to another sector of the brain. You know that. You've seen those things. And this is a very important new development in neuroscience, and it is an avenue to pin down some of the stuff I'm talking about. The first blush of that was the Gestalt School in Germany in 1910 with Max Wertheimer, when they were doing black box, you know, experiments of sort of dots and stuff like that. It got a certain distance and then stopped. It was too black box. Are you familiar with Wertheimer's work in the Berlin School of Gestalt Psychology?
No.
A lot of the early work on pattern. For example, you would get three dots. This is Max Wertheimer and his crowd. They would say, you get three dots and you see a triangle. And they thought that was interesting. How do you get three dots and see a triangle?
The angles at which they're arranged might form the dots might be at the corners of an imaginary triangle.
Exactly. The mind closes them. And he got so far as to, in one of his experiments, there's a wonderful little book by, I think it's Gregory, called Experiments in Visual Perception, where he got two lines and then a gap, two lines and then a gap, two lines and then a gap. And so you get one, two, three, four, eight lines, and he says, well, you see them as three because you see them in groups of two. Now, that's obvious enough, but what was interesting was he noticed something else, which was that in between the two, it was a brighter light. That was the amazing thing. And I put this to test with my students at one time. I said, do you see a brighter light? I did. And they looked for a while, and they said, yeah, if you put two lines and they're closer together than two here, there's a bright, the page is lighter. And then he came up with the notion that the figure ground, that was very important in figure ground theory, that the ground slips behind the figure. That's all in the Gestalt stuff. So that's very well studied and written about.
I think that amply answered the question. I think we need to wrap up.
Okay.
I'll stop. Thanks again. That's fantastic.
You're welcome.